Hey everyone, and welcome back to my channel. Today I want to start the reading vlog for the third new to me author I want to read this year, and that is Ursula K Le Guin. So I have The Left Hand of Darkness here with me. This is the book that I have chosen to be my introduction into this author, and in this vlog we will read this book together and see whether I will love this, which I hope I will. This is a very beloved kind of sci-fi classic. Now, I'm not very well versed in sci-fi, so we'll see how it goes. Do I know anything about this book? No. I think it somehow deals with gender in an interesting way, but apart from that, no idea. But I am ready to explore. The way this works is that I will update you after I have read 25% of the book, 50% of the book, and then 75% of the book, and at the end, when I'm finished, I will give you my final verdict, so you can really follow me on this journey through this book. So I'll talk to you when I have read the first quarter, and I can tell you a little bit more of what this is actually about. I am now a quarter of the way into The Left Hand of Darkness, and I have read the first six chapters, so you have a little bit of a marker of where I am. In this book, we are following a character. I think he is a human from Earth, and he is part of this like big like union, and he's sent to this planet to see whether the people who live there want to become part of this union. So basically what I'm imagining is something like the EU, and he's the kind of representative of that being sent to a new possible like member planet. He has a bit of a hard time, so he's been staying there for 2 years now, and he has made his position clear. Everyone knows that he is an alien to this planet, and he finally has got the invitation to talk to the king of this one nation on this planet. Now, this planet is a little bit special because the people who live there don't have a sex. They basically have this period where they are sexually active. I think it's called the Kammering. And during that time, they do have a sex, but then the rest of the year, they don't. And so they are very confused by this person who shows up and is a man all the time. And that is kind of like the gender bending thing that is in this book. Now, even though this is happening, because we are seeing the story from the point of view of this alien who is used to having a sex, he refers to pretty much everyone as he in the book, and will discuss kind of like gender confusions when people show like traits of both genders. So traits that we would typically assign to women and to men. So it discusses gender in that way. But since this is an older book, I wouldn't expect like super grand new ideas from a today's perspective, I would say. So this book starts out with a parade, which I always think is kind of a fun and weird way to start a book. So we are seeing this parade where there's like a ton of people mentioned. We have no idea what that means, what they do, who they are, what's happening. It's like very confusing, but it really reminded me of the beginning of Grace of Kings. So that was a kind of like a fun little reminder. But I have to say that at the beginning of this book, I was very lost for quite a while, and it definitely took some time to get into this. Now, I'm not a big sci-fi reader, so I was kind of expecting this to be more challenging for me, just because I'm not really used to the concepts and ideas. It might sound strange because I do read a lot of fantasy, so it might seem like, you know, exploring different worlds is just what I do in my literature like all the time. But I think sci-fi is still a little bit different because the themes are just very different. And in this one, we do explore this gender theme, and then also this idea of a nation, of rulers, and you know, this like bigger union thing, and how a person who is used to be like the only one in control would react to that, I guess. So there is a lot of like political aspects to this, but then later on, like when we get closer to the 25% mark, there's also more of a religious, like spiritual aspect. And that's actually what intrigued me most so far. So that part definitely pulled me more into the story, and I was really intrigued to see more about that. Now, the whole setup of the story also reminded me a lot of the Imperial Watch series by Anne Leckie. So I guess she took inspiration from this book. I mean, the like overall theme, or like the overall plot of that book, is very different, but we also have this view on gender where basically it is not gendered. So in the Imperial Watch series, we have the alternate perspective where our main character does not see differences between gender, but there is a part in the series where she goes to a planet where they still do differentiate between two genders, and it's like very challenging for her. The difference is that in the Imperial Watch series, everyone is assigned she as a pronoun, and here it is he. So I thought that was a bit more gender bending for us, just because we're so used to the kind of default being a man. So making the default being a woman just worked so much better for me personally, especially also in the German translation, where that goes even further, because we do have gendered expressions for like so many more things. But apart from that, I think that Anne Leckie took a lot of inspiration probably from this, because in the Imperial Raj we have an empire, here we have this union, but we still have like one kind of organization in the broadest sense that is trying to get planets to come together in a way. So yeah, those are like the kind of comparisons that I've seen so far. I am intrigued. I still don't really know what to expect from this, like where this will be going. We have now, in the 25% mark, also started entering another nation that is on this planet. So I'm intrigued to see how that will go now. We also do get other parts, like other chapters that are not from the point of view of this human who is sent there. So yeah, I'm just intrigued to see how it goes, and I will update you once I'm halfway through the book. So I'm pretty much halfway through The Left Hand of Darkness now. I have finished reading the first 10 chapters, and I don't really have anything more to say apart from what I've already said. We do follow our main character along a little bit more in this like new country, and that new country is more of a bureaucracy. I can't say the English pronunciation of that. But yeah, it's like very, very different from that first country we have explored with them. And so far, I'm not very interested in it, unfortunately. Like, there seems to be something going on, but I have no idea our main character doesn't really have any idea. So yeah, I'm just going along, but I don't have any strong feelings about this so far. I actually really liked the kind of like short story bit that we got in here, where it talked about a like historical kind of like myth, basically, about two families who were rivals and how they found a way to open up to each other and end a feud. But yeah, overall, my enjoyment level of this is pretty okay. Nothing crazy yet. So yeah, we'll see. Also, the like whole sexuality thing has been explained a little bit more by now. What I think is quite funny is that this uses bisexual as a word to describe a people where there is men and women. So basically where there is two sexes, instead of what we would see as bisexual today. So that's quite interesting as well. You definitely feel its age with this one, and that surprises me, because from what other people have said about this, this book and this author, I thought it would feel more timeless, but to me it doesn't. It feels very much of its age, and I talked a little bit about that with like using all the male pronouns and describing all the people who are neither man nor woman as men. So yeah, it just feels kind of backwards from today's perspective, even though I do understand that this was different when this was first published. So mixed feelings all around. I'm continuing to read this while taking a bath now, and I hope I can give you another update after that. So I'm now 75% through The Left Hand of Darkness. I have read the first 16 chapters now, and I still have no idea what I'm actually reading here. The plot is very confusing to me. Like, I do not know what's going on. Like, what are they doing? I mean, it does make sense in the way that these things like follow each other, but at the same time I'm like, what is happening? Like, it's so chaotic in a way. I don't know. But basically what we have in this like third part of the story is that we get sent to kind of like a prison camp, like in Siberia. I think that is what it's inspired by a little bit. Then we have something that happens, and then we have characters who are traveling for a long, long time. So I don't know. Will they ever even arrive? Will anything happen when they do? I don't know. I really don't know how I feel about this book. With a lot of these classics, I think they're more beloved for their concepts than their plots. So yeah, I'm majorly confused by this book, but not in like a strictly bad way, just in a what the hell kind of way. So we'll see. I don't even know what to tell you about this, apart from that the traveling bit was way too long. It definitely gave me some like Mount Doom, Lord of the Rings vibes, but that's not what I came here for. And still, the way that gender and sexuality is discussed in here, it's just not what I expected it to be. And maybe I should have like checked my expectations for a book that was published in the late 60s. So it might be my fault, but I still feel like a lot of what is discussed in here makes non-binary people seem like very weird, and it is expressed a lot how weird they are. And yeah, I don't know. I'm intrigued to read the introductions. There is 3 introductions in this edition. We have one by David Mitchell, one by Gina Miewel, I never know how to say the name, I'm sorry, and then one by the author herself. So I will read the final bit now, and then I will read the introductions, and then I will talk to you about my final verdict. But right now I'm just hella confused. I don't know what is going on. I don't understand. And I think I'm just not quite smart enough for like the philosophical bits that are in here. Like, we now learned what the left hand of darkness means, but that's just, I don't know. I feel like that was just like a weird proverb kind of situation where you can interpret it 7 billion different ways and all of them are smart. I don't know. We'll see. I'll finish this. I'll let you know what I think. So I finished reading The Left Hand of Darkness and I wanted to do the final little clip for that vlog. I'm having a migraine right now, so I might not be that coherent as I would like to be, but I'm trying my best, so I hope we can talk about this book a little bit. But honestly, reading this book, I definitely felt like I'm missing something, like even without the migraine. We were not really clicking. Now this might be just because these sci-fi classics are just not for me, but the last quarter of this book was just kind of all over the place for me. There is something quite traumatic that happens in this last quarter, and I felt nothing at all, which was very sad. Overall, I decided to give this book 3.5 stars. I think that it was an interesting idea, but I don't really see that I have personally gained anything from reading this book, which is usually what I expect from a classic. So I think that this was probably very thought-provoking at the time, but I don't think that it really works that well nowadays anymore. And there is 3 introductions in this book. One is by David Mitchell, which I found to be not very helpful. Then one is by China Miewill. I never know how to say the name. And that one I found to be quite interesting, definitely much more helpful for me to kind of like understand why people see this book in such high regards. And the last one is by Ursula K Le Guin herself, and that one I also enjoyed quite a bit. And the parts that I liked in these introductions is where it talked about Ursula K Le Guin's stance towards her own book later in her life, which I found to be very relatable, because it seems like feminists have criticized her work for not doing enough already when it was published, and later in her life she accepted that maybe she could have been even more brave and done even more with the gender concepts in this book, especially with the using he, his pronouns everywhere, which is one part that just really I didn't like. But I also really didn't like how the characters talked about gender in this book, because yeah, it's just very static view. And there is this moment right at the end where something happens and our main character realizes how much he has gotten used to the society of genderless people he was living in. But that was just a little too late for me. I don't know. I just would have liked to have the main character have a more open mind, which I do understand why it is done when this was published in the late 60s, but still, for me personally, I didn't really love that. So yeah, I think that's all I can say without talking about spoilers. So for everyone who has read this book and wants to hear a little bit more about my thoughts, I will go into a few spoilers here. But if you haven't read the book and you don't want to know anything about it, then I would recommend you leave this video. And I thank you so much for watching, and I hope you'll be back for the next reading vlog. So the thing that I just really don't understand about this book is the last third. Like, why do we spend a third of the book traveling on a glacier Why is that happening? Like, when I go into a sci-fi that is kind of like thought-provoking and, as they say in these introduction, like thought experiments, I want to explore that thought experiment. And instead, we were on the ice. And if I had known that this would turn into kind of like a survival story, I would have never picked this up, because that's just nothing I'm even vaguely interested in. Like, not at all. I would never read a book about people climbing a mountain, or I don't know, maybe I would read a book about people who travel through the desert, because I just really like the desert. But these like icy, cold, very deadly scenarios, I don't care. I don't care about that. So the last third of this book, really, it did nothing for me. And I was sitting there when they first talk about this journey, I was sitting there being like, I hope this is just gonna be one chapter where it talks about how hard it all was. And then we go back to what this book is actually about. And that is like this society on this planet, these nations, what they're doing, and these political machinations that we have been seeing. But no, we travel through or on a glacier for one third of a book about an alien planet where there is no one. Absolutely no one apart from these two characters that are traveling on the glacier. And I could not. I was bored out of my mind. And I don't know. I don't know what kind of choice that was. I think it was supposed... I put the book down now with a migraine. It's really hard to hold everything up. I suppose it was meant to build the characters and their relationship. But it really didn't. And then we have that scene at the end where the person, whatever their name was, gets shot because they're trying to cross the border again on their skis, and there's, or skis, you say ski in English, and they're shot and they die. And I felt nothing but like three big question marks over my head, because what was that? What was that? And I think this is supposed to say something about love, but then I felt so icky with the way they discussed this whole thing, because they're talking about how they wouldn't be able to physically be together, and or that they could, but then they couldn't have a child again, or something like that. There is some reference to that. So it makes it seem like they're from such different species that they could not, you know, be together in a physical way. But then at the beginning of the book, it talked about how this kind of humans that we see on this planet probably came about because of a genetic experiment where normal like gendered humans mixed with some kind of proto-human that was on this planet. And I'm like, what if they could mix, then why can't you be with that person? I don't understand, because, you know. And it's just like, I just didn't get what it was trying to say there. It just always felt like, and it literally does that, it felt like alienating people who do not adhere to our gendered view of the world. That's what this book does. And I probably would need to discuss this with like trans and non-binary people who love this book to understand why they do, because for me it's very, very hard to see from my like cis woman point of view. I just really didn't understand why this was celebrated so much in like queer spaces. So if that applies to you, please leave a comment, because I would really, really love to know why you love this book if you are a trans or non-binary person specifically, because I know that a lot of people love this book anyways, like, but like for this specific group, I would really like to hear what you loved about it so much. I don't know. I think I really liked the beginning. It was interesting to kind of explore this world with our character, but the further we got into the plot, the more I was disinterested and really didn't understand what the whole point was. What is the thing that I was supposed to take away from this book? I'm really unsure about that. So, unfortunately, as I said, this wasn't a big win for me. And as I alluded to before, the moment when the ship comes down and the other humans from like outside of this planet land, and our main character sees a woman and he's like, oh my god, I'm so not used to this anymore because now I've gotten so used to these genderless people all around me. It just was too late and it wasn't examined in a way that for me would have made up for all of the like alienating comments that we had before that. Overall, unfortunately, not a story that I loved. And I'm not quite sure whether I will continue trying books by the author just because I feel like the genre isn't really for me. It's just really not something that I like exploring further. But if you do have recommendations where I could go from here, then definitely let me know in the comments as well. So thank you so much for watching. I hope it was still entertaining even though I felt a bit lost with this book. It was definitely an experience nonetheless, and I will talk to you very soon. Bye!